Stavroula Chrysanthopoulou is a assistant professor of biostatistics in the School of Public Health and also the director of the statistical consulting unit, which we might have more to say about during the meetup. And with that, I will hand it off to her.
Hello, everyone. It's great to be meeting you all. Thank you very much for the invitation, Jason. I met Jason, I think last semester, it was our first contact. And we had a discussion about further collaboration between your center and the statistical consulting unit. So I think this is a great opportunity, first of all, for me to learn more about your center and also to provide some feedback from our center and our Department of Biostatistics. We were thinking with Jason to have a session at some point on multi-level modeling. And by the way, I would also like to say hi to Jason, one of my former students who has taken one of my former students who has taken the course in multi-level modeling. At some point we talked with Jason about this session about data reduction methods and so on. But before I start with a few slides that I created for today as a very high level overview of some of the main data reduction methods that probably most of you are familiar with or you have heard of, I would like to also give you some more information about my background. So as Jason mentioned, I'm an assistant professor at the Department of Biostatistics, and my field of expertise is in complex predictive models, micro-simulation models in particular. I don't know if any of you is familiar with this type of modeling. So essentially, these models use Markov chain Monte Carlo techniques in order to accurately predict individual trajectories we use these models to calibrate them to underlying populations that we're trying to describe. And we are using these methods in medical decision making, cost effectiveness analysis, comparative effectiveness research, in order to evaluate the impact of certain interventions on public health policies and things like that. Some applications I'm working on models. I have built a micro simulation model that describes the natural history of lung cancer. And I'm also collaborating with people from Brown University and one of my collaborators have developed another micro simulation model that describes the natural history of dementia. And I also have another collaboration with some doctors in Boston University about calibrating a cohort-based state transition model that describes the epidemic of opioid use disorder. So that's my background. I think it's very different from the background of most of you in this informal session. I'm also working with big data, and I'm trying to. I'm interested in predictive methods, statistical methods to make accurate predictions, as I mentioned before, statistical methods for estimation or calibration procedures. Sometimes I also borrow ideas from the data reduction techniques that we will discuss today, either to calibrate some of these models or to assess the predictive accuracy of these models. Also, a quick note is I have used data reduction, statistical methods for data reduction, but I've never applied these methods to data from neuroscience and so on. As I mentioned before, you can learn more about the Department of Biostatistics and our statistical consulting unit. I have the link for our department's website, and there are some faculty in our department that are also conducting research in neuroimaging data and things like that. So you can definitely look at our website and look at our faculty and see, based on our research profile, which professor may already conducting work in your field. So I know that Dr. Lauren Crawford has done some work on modeling massive data sets and molecular and biological field. And there's also Dr. Annie Eloyan, who I think is also affiliated with the neuroscience department, if I'm correct. So maybe some of you already know her, and she's doing statistical analysis. Her field of expertise is statistical research of brain images and so on. So just a very high-level overview of some of the methods that I've used, I've seen, and with a quick search, I think they're also relevant to neuroscience research, is of course the principal component analysis and some variants of this, like the multiple correspondence analysis, multidimensional scaling, linear discriminant analysis, and cluster analysis. So the topic of data reduction, this field is a very broad field, and there are numerous approaches and methods or variants of these methods that are implemented in real life examples. And I think although the data may change, as I mentioned before, I'm mainly more familiar with analyzing data from observational studies or clinical trials and so on, the ideas can be applied to any type of data and can be expanded to solve more complicated problems. So in a brief discussion we had with Jason, he mentioned to me that usually some of the most common questions in your field that people try to answer by using data reduction methods are whether essentially you are with the data that you collect from neuro images, by analyzing this data, do you see a real signal or a noise? What's the best approach to identify important associations or even cluster observations based on certain characteristics? How do you evaluate the performance of any model or statistical method or algorithm you use? And how, of course, you decide whether the approach that you have applied is, first of all, relevant, correct, and the best among other alternatives that you may have. So these are questions hard to answer, of course, and sometimes, I mean, they require years of research to be able to come up with a good answer to any of those. However, the data reduction techniques that we are all probably familiar with are useful approaches for maybe answer or approach or answering some of these questions. I will start probably with the most famous or popular approach that I've seen used in the neuroscience field. And this is the principal components analysis, and very briefly, the way I've seen it, I understand it, and I have implemented is to essentially try to, you have essentially a set of a large number of variables that you measure for, that you get measurements for multiple individuals, and of course, all this information is somehow correlated. So applications that I've seen are in questionnaires, for example. And for example, you may have a questionnaire that tries to evaluate some feature, some characteristic of the subject with a total of 20 or 25 questions. And when you analyze this data, it's very hard to find strong correlations or indications of probably the effect of an intervention on each one of these measurements, because they all these are correlated measurements. They are not independent. One of the major assumptions that most of the statistical techniques require. So you try to take advantage of this correlation in the system And from these 20, for example, or multiple variables that we have, usually this method started with an application to continuous variables. You try to create a set of linear combinations, and instead of using, which are essentially independent of each other, and instead of using 20 variables in the analysis, you end up with using maybe 3 or 4 or 5 linear combinations of these variables. And these linear combinations are essentially the principal components of this analysis. So you essentially reduce, for example, in this particular case I just mentioned, you reduce the data dimensionality from 20 to 3 or 4 or 5. One issue, and there are also variations of this technique. As I mentioned before, classical PCA involves continuous measurements, but there's also the multiple correspondence analysis when all the measurements are categorical, quantitative characteristics, or there's also an extension of this methodology to the so-called nonlinear PCA, where the set of covariates of variables we try to combine in the linear combinations can be a mixture of both qualitative and quantitative characteristics, both continuous and categorical outputs. Some of the benefits of this method is, as I mentioned before, you work with only a few principal components instead of a very large number of variables. And these components are independent to each other, namely you can further use them to conduct further statistical analysis. One issue with this technique is usually these linear combinations are hard to interpret. It's hard to understand what each linear combination represents. And you also miss some part of the variability by keeping only, as I mentioned in the previous example, maybe 10% of the PCAs that you can create, of the total number of principal components that you can calculate. And usually this percentage of variability that you lose, first of all, the number of principal components that you will use is arbitrary. There are not any strong statistical methods to help you decide what's the best number of principal components that you should keep in your analysis. And as I mentioned, interpretation can be challenging. The other method that I've seen being used a lot in neuroscience is the multidimensional scaling, here you try to essentially visualize, group your subjects based on their measurements in multiple covariates that you have collected data from, and you try to project these differences or similarities among the subjects in a smaller dimension. Let's say that you have p starting variables, you try to project the subject based on the score, on a score that they have in those continuous variables to a smaller dimensional space. The issue here is that from the X measurements, this analysis, this approach is focusing on only pairwise differences among the individual, among the subjects in the study, and that's one of the limitations. In an analogous way, as I mentioned for the PCA, there is the standard multidimensional scaling that started. It was based on continuous outcomes, but there is also a non-metric approach of this method that extends the theory when the set of covariates of variables that you are using for this analysis also includes categorical outcomes. So it's a useful method because you're able to group your subjects and essentially represent, visualize the differences or similarities of the of subjects in a smaller parameter space. Some of the problems with this approach is that it's based only on pairwise differences. So from a multidimensional space of the X matrix, you need to come up with pairwise differences. So probably essentially you need to come up with a score from the X variables and then compare pairwise differences in among individuals in order to project them to a smaller dimension. And although it's useful to visualize the results from this technique, of course, it's hard to create more graphs. It's difficult to comprehend graphs that are in, first of all, I think you cannot create graphs. It's hard to comprehend the results if you're talking about more than three dimensions. Another approach that we've seen a lot being used in this field is the linear discriminant analysis, where here from the X variables that, again, we start with the simpler approach, which is the linear combinations of X of a set of variables that are continuous. So from this set of continuous variables, you try to create linear combinations, the classifiers, based on which you try to group subjects based to certain characteristics in K pre-specified groups. And you try to project the subject to a smaller dimensional space and visualize essentially the similarities and the different groups that we can create based on the classifiers that you have created for the original variables. Now, one issue with this technique, the good thing is, again, it's a good technique for visualizing the subjects, groups of subjects for your analysis and finding homogeneous or heterogeneous groups. And then it's also a useful technique if you want to predict the group membership of a new subject in the study based on the X characteristics. However, again, as we mentioned before, it's hard to visualize the results in more than three dimensions. And in this particular case, you can use this analysis only if you know beforehand, or there is a way to pre-specify beforehand the total number of groups that you want to create at the end. So this is a type of supervised pattern recognition, this approach. A similar idea, again, an idea of trying to find homogeneous or heterogeneous groups of subjects is the so-called cluster analysis. There are several algorithms and variations of algorithms for implementing this approach. Now, essentially with this analysis, you use the initial information from your continuous variables and you somehow create a multidimensional measure of difference from some multidimensional central points. And you try based on this based on these measurements of difference, you try again to group your subjects to classify your subjects into groups. But now, unlike the previous approach, the linear discriminant analysis, the number of groups is unknown. So this approach gives you the flexibility to create as many groups as necessary. However, this is a good and a bad thing because sometimes the number of groups, the choice for the total number of groups can be arbitrary. This approach can result in overlapping groups, in which case, if you are using this approach for predictive purposes, it's hard to decide for some subjects whether they belong to one group or the other. So these are the main, some of the main challenges or disadvantages of this method. And I think these are the things I wanted to cover in this very brief high-level overview. And I'll be happy to discuss with you more applications or ideas about some of these approaches that we've seen in your research. And I also compiled a list of references at the end with some useful information, some useful papers or books that you can find some interesting, some more detail about some of these topics. And you can check some of these are also related to your field of expertise.